Hi guys, this is Andrew with Headphones.com. Welcome to the Headphone Show, and today we're going to take a look at this. This is the Hi-Fi Man HE400 SE Planar Magnetic Over-Ear Open Back Headphone. Yes, another one. Anyways, this one comes in right at around $149. Let's check it out. Now, as a disclaimer, this unit was sent to me by Hi-Fi Man for evaluation, but I've not been paid to say anything in particular about it, and all thoughts and opinions are my own. Big thanks to Hi-Fi Man for sending along for a review. Now, let's get into the review, and as I mentioned at the very beginning of this video, that this is yet another of the myriad of HE400 version headphones. There was the original HE400, then there's the HE400i, then there's the HE400i 2020, then there's the HE4XX, then there's the HE400 SE, there's the HE350, and then various different iterations of that, and then there's the HE5XX, there's the Deva, you get the idea. There are many of these entry-level or more budget-focused Hi-Fi Man headphones that are kind of based on a similar idea. Now, they're not all like this. This one does use a double-sided magnetic design for the driver, which is similar to what they did with the Deva and the HE5XX, which are actually acoustically the same headphone, if anybody's unaware. And if you're unsure about that, I've already done a video on those two. But in my mind, this is a very interesting headphone because it kind of supplants both of those as far as the price to performance value for sound quality headphone within that range. In fact, as I will get to in this review, out of all of these Hi-Fi Man headphones, the entry level ones, up until the Sundara, this one is currently my favorite. And in many ways, I think we'd be able to call the HE400 SE kind of a baby Sundara. But for the moment, let's talk about the build, design, comfort, and aesthetics. And this is actually one of my favorite designs, with the more standard looking round circular cup here, which is different from what they did with the Deva and the HE5XX. They had somewhat of a different chassis going on there, and I prefer this one. I think the reason why I like this one is because it reminds me of the older style, but it also doesn't feel like the older style because this is considerably lighter. This is all just sort of plastic on the top here. Now, thankfully, they're using the newer style headband here and not the one that's found on the Sundara and the Ananda and possibly a number of other ones. That headband needs to die in a fire. It's terrible. You know, apart from the fact that when you would extend the cups, it would scratch the inside of the actual piece that moves, you couldn't actually extend it without scratching the inside of the arm. It also didn't have any cup swivel, except for on the Ananda BT. They somehow managed to add a notch into the side of it, and that gave it cup swivel, but even that, it's still, the clamp is too much. And this is so much more comfortable than any of those headphones. So a big thumbs up from me, with a small exception here, and it's that, yeah, I mean, it doesn't feel all that premium. It feels a little bit rickety. I don't have any problems with this at this price point, okay? So, you know, it keeps the weight down. It doesn't feel particularly sturdy and well-built, but at the same time, you know, at $150, I can't really complain all that much. And it is an improvement ergonomically over the other headband design, the alternative. So good job there. Now, speaking of comfort, this is thankfully very lightweight, at least for a planar magnetic headphone. And when I put it on, this is how it looks, right? I don't find any hot spots or anything like that. I can wear it for long periods of time, and so I have no issues with the comfort or anything like that. I like the silver and black. I like the black headband. It's a very no-nonsense kind of look, and you guys know me. You guys know this is exactly the kind of thing that I like. And then actually, the pads here are not the same pads that you find on the Sundara and some of those other ones. It's more of a velour material for the hybrid part, and I do like that for comfort. It is more comfortable as a result. Now, I've said a number of good things, and I have to say one bad thing, and it's that this cable is hilarious. What is going on here? Oh my god. So this cable actually reminds me of the old Hi-Fi Man cable that was on the original HE500. And so that I remember there was a sort of a silver cable that at the time I didn't realize was actually just really poor quality. And it eventually even just broke over time. So maybe that would happen with this. Time will tell. But yeah, this cable is possibly the worst cable I've ever come across. And that's saying something, because Hi-Fi Man cables have never been particularly good. This is worse than the surgical tubing stuff. And it's also quite microphonic. So, you know, it's functional, it does work, you know, to get you going. But I do highly recommend getting, you know, an aftermarket cable if you can. Not an expensive one, just get a $30 one off of Amazon. And yeah, that would this is the first thing that I would replace. Now, let's talk about sound quality with the HE400 SE. And I'm going to begin by talking about the objective stuff, the measurements, and the frequency response. You guys know how it goes. Of course, if you are totally unfamiliar with how to read frequency response, I've done a whole video on that, and I'll leave a link to that in the description. That's always going to be there. And I'm going to throw the graphs up on the screen here for you guys so you can take a look. In general, we do want the frequency response of this headphone to kind of match the dotted line there, but it doesn't have to. The dotted line is just a known data point. It's a known reference point. So if it deviates, it's not the end of the world. It's just worth analyzing it in relation to that known data point. So looking at the frequency response, it does sort of taper off there in the bass a little bit as it goes into the sub bass. I actually did an on-head measurement to double check that this is the actual behavior that I get when I'm actually listening. And it does match. So I was able to get a seal on the rig and on my head. So that's no problem. And then as it gets into the mids, it doesn't follow the Hartmann contour. So it doesn't have the kind of dip there in the lower mids, giving a little bit more presence and body there, which is totally fine. It doesn't have to match the target there. That's more of a preference thing than anything else. It is a little forward there in the mids, giving it just a hint of that sort of honkiness that can sometimes come across by elevation there, followed by it's actually only really noticeable because it's followed by the dip, the typical HiFiMan dip that shows up at around 1.5 2K. This is the area that I EQ on this headphone, but you know, looking at the rest of it, obviously this is not a headphone that requires EQ to sound good. It actually sounds really nice. It follows the target exceptionally well. And this is also why I say that this is kind of like a baby Sandara in a sense, because for the ear gain region, apart from that 2K dip, the rest of the ear gain region is very similar, if not the same as what you get with the Sandara. There's a few areas where it's not quite the same, but it's very, very close. And of course, if anybody's wondering, the Sandara is the more expensive $350 headphone. And I've been comparing the two side by side, and they do sound very similar as well. But there are some differences, and we'll get to that. So moving into the treble, this is extremely well balanced. And actually, there's a region in the upper treble, like 11, 12K, where this is almost like exactly how I want the balance to be. You can see there's sort of like the areas where it's kind of over the target a little bit is kind of what I would recommend for a target, just because I do find that this target tends to roll off there in the upper treble a little bit. And so the HE400 SE in my mind really does nail that balance. So it's not elevated. There's no harmonic that's boosted over other harmonics. You see a little bit of, you know, oddness there at around like 7K, but you know, that doesn't really come across in any, you know, meaningful way. Also keep in mind that the dip that you see at around like 8, 9K, that's supposed to be there. That's the concha interaction. So there's a part of the ear, physical part of the ear that is interact, that the frequencies are interacting with. So all good headphones have some sort of dip there. So that is expected behavior. Now, as I mentioned, I call this a baby Sandara in a way, and the reason why I say that is because for most of its frequency response, it is very similar. It has the same strengths and has the same weaknesses, barring one. The Sandara, at least the whatever the latest version is with the latest pads, the Sandara doesn't have quite the same dip there at around 2K. That is not the case on the current revision Sandara. And at least all the Sandaras that I've been testing, they do seem to have a little bit better bass extension, but that's really the only difference there. So, you know, yes, the Sandara does adhere to this target a little bit more, you know, above 1K. And in that sense, the Sandara is still a little bit better than the HE400 SE. But for the rest of the tuning, you know, it's very close. It's close enough to where I think you're getting a lot for your money, considering it's more than twice the price for the Sandara. So that's one of the reasons why I really like this headphone at this price. Okay, so let me summarize the tonal balance and frequency response here for you guys. This is essentially a mostly neutral sounding headphone, fairly even across the board with an even spectral balance. It's got a little bit of a dip there in the mids at around 2K, 1.5 to 2K, meaning that there is almost like an artificially enhanced sense of stage. That's often one of the areas where they do that. The other area is often 3K, but I think 2K is a smarter place to do it. So it's that I think is fine. I would personally prefer it filled in though, just to get a little bit more richness of tone for that region, and also to kind of avoid that slightly more pronounced section below 1K, because as a result of the dip, it's a little bit, you know, forward there, making it just a little bit, you know, nasally at times. But let's get into the subjective stuff now. I'm going to talk all about the technical performance, the detail retrieval, dynamic soundstage, and all the rest of that stuff. So when it comes to detail for trailing ends of tones and microdynamics, for the most part, this is solid for the price. I don't really think there's any issues with this, especially, you know, in the mids, it's quite nice. And thankfully, it doesn't have that sort of smeared effect and sort of haziness and graininess that was going on kind of in the upper mids for the HE5XX and the Deva. This is a lot cleaner than both of those. Well, that's the same headphone acoustically, but this is a lot cleaner there. If there is a drawback here, and again, this is the thing that I noticed the most comparing the HE400SE to the Sindara, so that the HE400SE, while not being as detailed, is also not as fast sounding. What do I mean? Well, the initial leading edge of the transients feel a little sluggish on this by comparison. But at the same time, you still get the same excellent sense of instrument separation and incisiveness. So again, if you're listening to vocal tracks with two voices or more than two voices, harmonies and things like that, it's really easy to isolate the individual lines on this headphone, just like it is with the Sindara. And also, the sense of space and stage is also excellent on this. So at least for the price. I mean, comparing this to the HD650, 6XX and 58X and those that are, you know, around this price and a little more expensive, this is definitely better. It doesn't have the three blob effect there for the imaging. And so overall, for the sense of resolution and detail and clarity, for the price, this is good, even though, you know, it doesn't quite match what's going on with the Sindara. It's close enough to where this is definitely, you know, better value, between the two. The Sindara is the obvious choice there. It's just more than twice the price. Now, the other thing is for dynamics and punch and slam, this also does not have much going on for it at all. And that's an area where I think the Sindara is, once again, a little bit better. So it's interesting when I took a look at the driver here, it is double-sided and it is very similar looking to what you get with the HE5XX and the Deva. For whatever reason, it's horizontal on this one, where it was vertical on that one. So that's interesting. I think this is just a refinement or iteration on that process. And what they've done here is achieved a much better sounding headphone, in spite of the somewhat sluggish transients and attack that just doesn't seem to quite have the same snap that and crispness that the Sindara does. But for the rest of the aspects, it's very close. Lastly, for timbre, this is a typical planar magnetic kind of timbre to it, which some people find to be a little bit artificial sounding. And for all the strengths of this technology, I do think that is a general weak point, at least compared to some dynamic driver moving coil headphones, especially around this price, where you start to be able to get into, you know, the HD6XX potentially. I know it's more expensive, but, you know, that does have a much more natural timbre to it compared to this one. But the space and stage and separation advantages of this, or at least the space and stage advantages of this, definitely make it compete, I think, at a higher price tag than the $150 that it comes in at. Now, speaking of which, let's do some comparisons here. And I've been comparing it to the Sindara for most of the review, so, you know, you guys get a sense of that already. But compared to the HD6XX, let's do that one. Once again, this has a much more filled-in sense of space and stage, even though it's not super spacious. Like, don't get me wrong here, this is not an HD800S, and honestly, even the Harmonic Dyne stuff is, like, more spacious than this. But it's not as warm sounding, because that has a little bit of bloom there in the lower mids and upper bass. This has a more linear response there, which means that it also doesn't follow the Harman contour. It's got presence there, but at the same time, not as much as the 6XX. And then this is also a little bit more, has a bit more elevation there in the treble, giving a little bit more clarity and sparkle up top, but it is still very smooth. That, if you're going to take one thing away from the presentation here, or the description I'm giving here, is that the treble for this is shockingly smooth. And I say shockingly because it seems to be something, a parameter in planar magnetic headphones that's not the easiest thing to do, at least in the examples that we typically have. And with this one, it is. So that's great. Now, once again, compared to the HE5XX/Deva, this is just a straightforward, better sounding headphone than that one. The HE5XX is quite hazy and grainy there, a little bit smeared for the image separation and distinction, especially in the mid-range. And this one isn't. This is giving subjective terms, but it's a much more balanced frequency response as well, especially in the treble. That has that peak there that shows up in the lower treble, and this does not. So this is a more smooth and pleasant listen overall, And so, yeah, I recommend this over the HE5XX. You know, I've been going back and forth to see, you know, if there's any reason to go for the HE5XX over this. And as far as I can tell, there isn't. Maybe the cable. Now, I know a lot of you guys want me to compare it against the HD58X. Unfortunately, I don't have one of those in, so I couldn't do that comparison. I think within that price range, you got to look at the HE4XX and the HE400i, you know, 2020. I haven't had a chance to hear the 2020 version of the HE400i, so maybe I'll get the HE400i 2020 in and then do a comparison or review and compare that against this one. And lastly, one final comparison worth making here is against the newer Sennheiser HD560S, which came out not that long ago. And I think it's worth making this comparison because even though the HD560S comes in at around $200, which is, you know, considerably more expensive, if you factor in, you know, buying a new cable, which would cost you like maybe $30, then you're looking at around $180 versus $200, and it starts to be a little bit more comparable. So I think they're both good headphones. There is a bit of a difference in terms of the tonal balance there. If you're looking for a smoother treble presentation, this time around, it's the HiFiMan HE400SE that gets the job done there, while the HD560S is a little bit more on the spicy side. At the same time, the HD560S is still a little bit more balanced in the mids, and I think a little bit more balanced overall, if you kind of zoom out and look at, you know, the overall frequency response. And while I think they both have reasonable technical performance for the price, it's really going to come down to whether or not you prefer a planar magnetic presentation or if you're looking for a dynamic driver presentation. So let me get my conclusion here. Do I recommend the HE400SE? If it wasn't clear by now, it's what I would buy if I were spending $150 on a headphone. Keep in mind, it does... I'm not going to say it requires an amplifier, but you do want to be running this off of an amplifier to get, you know, the most out of it. As an example, running it off of the SPL Phonator E here, I'm right at mid volume. So you do want to be using some sort of amplifier for this. And, you know, thinking about that, thankfully, there's a lot of motherboards out there that actually have headphone amplifiers like for the output. So you wouldn't really necessarily need to go out and buy one, but I would still recommend buying a cable for that. So apart from the cable, the HE400SE is a very easy headphone to recommend. And yeah, I'm thoroughly impressed with what they've been able to achieve here. By the way, guys, if you want to see more information and data and measurements of this, I'll leave a link in the description to a post that I've done on the headphone community forum where, you know, I post the data, but then I also go through some of my thoughts, my subjective thoughts there as well. And that's as I'm doing the testing as well. So, you know, I update these posts. And so if you want to see more information about this, definitely do check out that link there in the description where I've done those posts. In any case, that does it for this review. Thanks for taking the time to watch it. And I will see you guys in the next one. Bye for now.